So each and every person has their own primary love language. You know, in a relationship, you'll find that it is important to really share with your partner what your love language is and also express yourself to them so that they are able to reciprocate that to you. Today is Family Matters Relationship Clinic, and we are dealing with love languages, and I'm joined by an amazing couple, a beautiful lady and their husband who is a pastor. They're going to talk to us about their love language, and indeed when you look at them, there's love. I've already seen their love languages. So we're going to discuss about the love languages. Is yours words of affirmation? Is it gifting? Is it quality time? What could it be? Or is it even acts of service? So join me in this conversation on 203-1607-86-316-316. Ask questions, comment, you know, give them compliments, because I mean, you'll see them and then you'll agree with me that love lives here. Karibuni sana kwa studio, Pastor Shad.
Thank you.
And your beautiful wife,
thank
Hannah.
Thank you so much, Sally, for the honor. We really appreciate it.
Yes.
Thank you for even finding us favorable to be part of this show.
Karibuni sana.
So we are honored.
You're welcome.
Kawia kawia, tafika,
tumefika. Yes, finally, indeed, finally, you made it.
Yes.
Yeah, so maybe you can give us your full names. And
yes, my name is Pastor Shadrach Geshohe Mahinda.
Okay.
I serve at the Wisdom Sanctuary Church. I am a pastor there,
okay,
and a Bishop James Tuko Thika. And I've been a pastor there and worked also with the church for over 16 years.
Oh, wow.
So it's been an amazing.
Fantastic.
And that's why I met this beautiful, amazing woman of God.
Yeah.
So I'll allow her to introduce herself as well.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Sally, for having us today. Such an honor. My name is Hannah Wanjiro, wife to this amazing man. We've been married for now close to, actually, we are 6 years.
Yes, six years.
Wow,
yes.
Beautiful.
Yes, I'm an administrator in one of the varsity institutions here in Kenya. I'm a mom and a wife, and I love it. And I'm born again.
Fantastic.
Yes.
Wow. Awesome. And I'm sure my viewers and listeners, you've heard these are what were Biblia. Shadrach.
Yes.
Karibuni sana.
Thank you.
You know, of course, my first question is going to be how long you've been married. And you said it's 6 years. How is marriage like for you? Whom do I start with? Ladies first.
Oh, wow. For me, marriage has been amazing. God has been so faithful. 6 years in, and we are blessed with two amazing kids. We have a son who is 5 years old, and a daughter who is now around 2.7. Yes, and we've seen the goodness of God. I think one thing I would just say is that marriage requires work, and is a learning curve. But every day we just grow fonder with each other.
Fantastic.
It's amazing. It actually amazes me, because one of the myths or the stereotypes out there was that the first 2 years is your honeymoon. Then if you gonga 5 years, you guys are lucky. Like there's a dinner we went for couples, I think in our second year of marriage, and you could hear the stereotypes already when we were conversing with couples, and they were like, oh, how long have you been married? And we're like, okay, we're in our first year of marriage. And they're like, you guys haven't seen anything.
It's like, people, we should, you
like,
know?
Chill out. You haven't seen life yet in marriage.
You wait until you get to 4 or 5 years, and we are like, we were shocked. We're
funny,
what
there.
Are we supposed to expect, you know?
Yeah.
But then coming in to now six, I can only bless God.
Beautiful.
It's been amazing.
Amen.
Yes,
amen.
So back to you.
Well, marriage has been really amazing. First, we thank God. And God has been helpful to us. Number one is we're human beings. We have our own flaws. We have our own challenges. But one thing that we have learned is to always let God in and to allow him to be the driver. And that has made us realize so many things, that in marriage, there are moments where you have to decrease and allow God to increase. We've also learned about us being able to spend more time with God individually, taking care of our relationship with God.
Okay.
also affects our relationship mm-hmm. together as a couple. Mm-hmm. It affects my relationship with my children.
Yes.
Rather, it impacts. It also impacts my relationship with my mm-hmm. colleagues. Mm-hmm. I work in a very busy environment.
Okay.
So I meet with people. I meet with clients. Mm-hmm. And the other second thing I would say is also the power of accountability. Mm. You know, having mentors and people who can speak into your marriage.
Yeah. Yeah.
People who my wife can feel free and say, hey, this dude is not listening to me or misbehaving.
Is Bishop part of that?
Yes.
Because,
yes.
I posted him and I know it's powerful.
So we are submitted under Bishop James,
nice.
G Minor, and Reverend Agnes.
Mm.
They have been part of our journey.
Okay.
And also we have such an amazing best couple.
Yeah,
I mean, we meet with them almost every other time.
Okay.
You know, a gentleman called Nigel and a lady called Jerry.
Okay.
They also serve in marriage ministry mm-hmm. In another church.
True.
So we also have a group, you know, of accountability, you know, different couples where we come in together once in a while, we get to talk, you know, we share challenges, we celebrate victories,
milestones
and all that. So that has been a journey for us. Like my wife was saying, for us also when we were getting married, we were very eager to learn. Marriage is a journey of learning, you know, learning, adaptation.
Sure.
Willing to be able to adjust at any situation, any curveball that life will throw at you. And we have gone also for seminars, couple seminars.
So this is what makes them your marriage, you know, thrive and you're nurturing it through all this, you know. Okay.
Yeah.
So it doesn't have to be boring just because you're Christian, you're saved.
Because
people are like,
hey.
So, you know, without like a drink palace, you do all those things.
Yeah.
But it sounds like, you know, even Christians, saved people have fun in their marriages.
As we have a lot of fun in marriage.
I love that.
We have a lot of fun.
Yeah. And that's where we're going to come to, because we want to know, even during, because we're talking about love languages, what are those things that you do, blah, blah, blah. But is even the way she's looking at you, if that's a love language, because, hey, Anna, the listeners can't see, but I'm just telling my listeners, you should see. She's just staring at the husband like, well, so So back to you, Hannah.
Yeah, yeah.
What, you know, what do you know about love language, or what is your love language, you know?
Thank you for that question. It's interesting because in our first year of marriage, I wasn't really sure what that is, honestly. So by the
I like that, because most people actually don't.
And it's okay. But by the time I think we were hitting 2 years, is when I started recognizing, there's a way I like receiving love and expressing it also. And how that came about was he had taken me out for dinner because it was my birthday. And then as we as we reclined at the table, I realized that I wanted to share, you know, talk and have, you know, just intimate conversations with him. And so I was like, so, and when I would see he's distracted, it would bother me. So I realized this actually really matters to me. And so for me, my primary love language is quality time. I love spending time with him. Yes. I love just sit somewhere. It doesn't have to be expensive or anything, but just talk, catch up on life. How have you been?
Lovely.
You know, what are you experiencing in this season? You know, and just get to, you know, just talk more, you know. So that's my primary love language. For him, now I discovered later, as we now came in, is that I thought he was gonna also be a quality time person. And so later on is when I recognized that it's not that he didn't enjoy having that time with me. But there was just something missing. So I had a conversation with him because I had taken him out now for, I think it was an occasion that he had, either there's something he had. So I took him out. And I realized after we came home, he he just wasn't as happy as I expected.
Mm. So I asked, for you, I think we spent quality time.
Yeah. Yeah, we've been together.
I mean, we've been together and all that.
So I was like, okay, babe, what's going on here? Yeah. Like, why? I don't see, like, this meant really that. Yes, you appreciate it, but it's not like you really
enjoyed it as I thought you would.
So he goes on, he's like, babe, me, I'm a gifts person. You've never realized I love gifts. Yeah. You know, he loves being gifted.
Nice.
Yeah, but for me, it's quality time, any day, anytime.
I think
quality
it's just
time.
That we don't know what name to call these things.
Yes.
And you know, probably like in relation, now that you're new here, because that was what, first, second year?
Yeah.
You know, you're like a small child learning to walk. It's and true. Even discovering yourself.
Yeah,
you've never been married before.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's interesting that, you know, you're assuming your gift is quality time.
Yes.
Like,
like me.
Okay.
Yeah.
Pastor Shad, is that, you know, talk to us about your love language.
Let me just backtrack a bit. When it comes to love language, I would say for most relationships, on the onset, it's like something that is foreign, you know, coming from a setup where, especially, first of all, it depends on which setup you grew up with.
Yes.
You know, if you grew up seeing your parents expressing certain kinds of things, whether in front of you or in the house or in the public, most likely it shapes, you know. I come from a place where I never saw.
Yeah.
You see. For her, she comes from a family where she saw.
Yeah.
You see. And so for us, when we were getting into marriage, like what she was saying, we were still trying to get a footing. And it's amazing because sometimes you may think what your partner does to show affection or what you show your partner to as a form of affection should also resonate with her, you know, with him. You know, I like this, so she should like this. But it's different.
Yeah.
And for me, all along, give me anything, give me a gift, give me a pen, whatever, as in you've made my world.
Yeah.
Why? Because on my side, my interpretation is that you're thinking about me.
Yeah.
Wow.
You see, you're thinking about me. And I'm one person who cherishes gifts.
Okay.
You know, and for some reason, even people around me, when they bring it out, wow, this is amazing.
But we always assume that men don't like gifts, isn't it?
Exactly.
Yeah. We always want to receive flowers, chocolates.
Yeah, you see, the assumption is, and also what, let me say, the world has created is you gift women more and not the men.
True.
You see, but even nowadays, when you look at it, even on Valentine's, men are saying, okay, get me some car tires.
exactly. Or birthdays. You know?
Yes.
Yeah.
You know, take me out for something or a spa, you know, depending on how they feel, it's an expression of love.
Yeah.
You know, for most men, I would say is it's words of affirmation. You know, how are you talking to me? Is
there
respect in your tone? Is there love in your tone?
Appreciating.
You know, are you appreciative? Are you giving me compliments? Oh, hey, babes, that suit, that coat, today you are slaying in the boardroom.
You're
working
so hard for this family. Those things,
you know,
pat on the shoulder.
Those things that, you know, he comes at home and you're like, you know what, I know you've had a busy day. Just have rest.
Right.
Thank you for taking care of us.
Correct.
So different people will express. So mine was receiving gifts.
Okay.
You know, and like what you're saying, went on a date, and I was expecting. I'm like, okay, so
and
how she thinks it's the time.
And father like, ah, you know what, we're done.
Time.
You know, I've taken you out. It's a done deal.
But you see now, and that's where we, you know, I want to come into communication.
Yes.
Because I love how she started, and she said,
yes.
Quality time, and I told him. You understand?
Yeah.
She said, "I told him."
Yes.
Had you told her that you know you like gifts? And
not,
had you communicated?
Not really.
Yeah.
And that's why marriage is a journey.
Yes.
And one of the things that I really thank God about us is we've been taught by Bishop and Rev that sometimes in marriage, have those moments you call customer care sessions.
Yeah. Yes.
You know, customer care sessions is where you come, gloves off, you know, vulnerability, and you say, you know what, let's talk openly and put things on the table. And when you have that session is where you are able to express and say, hey, by the way, I like what you did, and I really appreciate it. But for me to get to that point, this is my way. You see,
and it has to be when you're both calm, not when we're fighting. Bring for me.
Yes. When actually it's confrontational, it doesn't work. You see. But it's a customer care session is just like when, you know, in any company they have a customer care desk. A customer will call in, oh, this product, blah 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 blah. And there's a salesperson on the other side. There's somebody who's saying, okay, I understand. I'm really sorry. We're going to make it up for you. You see. And we have those moments a lot. And sometimes it's either of us will call in, say, you know what, let's have a customer care desk. You know, before we sleep, or we're doing our errands. Most weekends we spend time together also with the kids. Like, hey, in the car, can we have a 5-minute session? Okay, let's talk. You know, and that time, I know even for me, I'm not defensive. And for her also, she's not defensive. And you address the issue, not the person.
Hannah, you're in this relationship. It's so beautiful. It's flourishing. It's thriving. I can see that. How do you keep this? How do you keep nurturing it and making it, you know, be the way it is right now?
Over time, honestly, I would, I don't want to sound spiritual, but like he said, he's a pastor, and I came in to help in that calling, of course, and I really thank God. But I have really come to appreciate the journey of us serving God together. And in that journey, we've gotten to just have moments where we get to study the words of God together, get to pray together. Most of the time, actually, and it's the two of us, honestly, just doing things in ministry together. And that, I think, has really strengthened the bond in the area of serving God. But then besides that, like he said, a customer care desk, you know, just having a session where you get to come together and we're like, okay, so where are we at? How are we doing so far?
Stock taking, very important.
Very important. And, you know, what can we do better? Is there any place where we are missing a mark, and how can we become better parents, better, you know, spouses to each other, better partners. And so that has really helped us. He is into one of the things that we realize, actually not just him, but even me, is that over time we learned that we really love outdoor activities. Yes, like hiking. Like hiking. And so most of the time we do hikes. And you will realize, actually, the beauty about an activity like hiking is that you will have most of the journey to just talk, you know, catch up.
So that's quality time.
Know, that's quality time. And he enjoys it too, because now he loves hiking. So he's not just seeing it from my end where it's like, oh, Hannah is the one enjoying it because it's quality time. But now he's also doing something that he loves, which is hiking. And so in that, we've realized that those activities, even as we bring them together, they get to really nurture the bond that we have. I don't know whether he has anything to add.
Yes. Other than serving God together, at some point when we started getting kids, we made a conscious decision not to have a full-time nanny. You know, and with this, we are able to share responsibilities in the house, and it keeps us together. It keeps us in check. You know, the moments I cook, she cooks. You know, I have my days, she has her days. You know, sometimes I cheat. I say, okay, guys, let's go out for dinner. Or I come home with pizza.
That means you've cooked for them.
On my days. But these days, we also get to nurture our love that way, you know. Why? Because we get to see each other in action. We help each other. We come in strongly, even with the kids, you know. We also nurture by having also that open space, like she said, you know. Can we talk? We have also pockets. You know, I'll come after work, relax, you know, when the kids have I've also gone, we're like, okay, we have our moments of talking, you know, how was your day, how was it, any challenge, anything that showed up, you know.
Okay.
She can always notice, you know, I work in a very busy environment. I'm like, hey, what's up? And I'll say, I'll also notice, you know, hey, what's going on. She will say, or she'll come and say, oh, you know, in the office today, there's this happening.
Yeah.
So we get to nurture also by talking.
Okay.
We pray together.
Yes.
And also we share the word a lot.
Okay.
You know, to be like, what's happening in your life? What is God saying?
And that's how you nurture this beautiful relationship.
Can I just add on to that? I think one of the biggest challenges, even as we have interacted with couples, like I said, in ministry, is that when you have a partner who is working overtime, so one of the things I've found is that you will find the wife or the husband is saying, okay, me, I usually come home early, so I get to sleep by this time, and him when he comes or when she comes, because she comes late.
I've already slept.
Yeah, they've already slept. Mm-hmm. So you never get to kinda ever have time to connect and just look at where you are in terms of your marriage.
Yeah.
And so that is one thing I found, that for us, as much as he has a very demanding job, I will always make sure that I get to see him that day, whether whatever time he comes, and we will get to at least even just have an hour.
And have dinner.
Yes, and have dinner together. Most people never understand, like, why do you have to wait for him? But the intentionality has to be there,
and it's in a nice way. It's not those things of stories we've had before that, you know. Not, it's in a very loving way. They're like you're saying, intentional as well. Loved like this. And for our listeners who you can't see, I'll just describe. These are very, you know, those couple that, that couple that is just warm and tight, and you should see the way they look at each other. Love like this, actually. It's a special dedication to my guest today in studio. Beautiful. And we, you know, welcome back and keep communicating, keep talking to us on 203-1607-86-316-316. And already I'm seeing there's a beautiful compliment to Hannah Wabibilia. Someone says they really admire how humble you are, submissive, and every time you talk, you have to refer to Percy and ask him, do you have anything to add? And also the bit that you said, I have to wait for him. No matter how late it is, I'll wait for him, eat with him, and just catch up, even if it's for an hour. So somebody admires that, and you know, yeah. And then we have also someone asking or saying, lovely couple, Sally, I have a very... To him, he thinks it's a funny, weird question. Is love language based on the tribe one comes from? Juwe? Mkale na love language pamoja, kidogo ni ngumu. That is one. Then, how do you communicate to someone that your love language is physical touch, Percy?
Let me first start with the question before.
Yes.
I do believe, like I said, number one, upbringing influences love language.
Yes.
For, let me say, the millennials, you know, these are the things that we started hearing or seeing as we were growing up and planning to get into marriage. But people who are ahead, baby boomers, probably they would never had that chance of expressing or showing that, expressing their love languages. However, I believe it was different.
Yes.
It's not that it was not there, it was just different.
But subtle.
Yeah.
Kind of,
you know, this love language has come through us being able to know.
Yes.
Reading
to give
books.
The names.
Yeah, yeah. Tunazipatia majina. But they were there. You know, I mean, I believe kitambo when Mzee went out and came, for him, that was like, this is my way of love.
Yes.
As much as it's duty, when he came back in the evening with things, it's duty, but it's the way I'm showing that I love my family. Now, coming back to tribe, and let me just also bring in the aspect of culture, tribe and culture. I believe it influences how people will either express or not express. However, my opinion is different. As a believer, I mean, the Bible is very clear, God is love. And how did God express his love? He sent his son to die for our sins. So that means as human beings, we are relational and we can show love. So every person or every married couple has a chance to create a different culture. Not on the basis of the tribe they have come from, but on the basis of what do you want to shape in your family.
Yes.
What do you want to ingrain in this family, in your kids when they are growing up? You know, I come back home and sometimes my wife will hug me. And my son will like, hey, I need a hug too. My daughter will also say, hey, I need a hug too. What are we doing is training a culture of expressing love, you see, within the family. And that's how I'd answer that person. Yes, there's that aspect, sisi, watua, he side. We don't know how to. But as an individual, you can make a choice.
You can.
And at the end of the day, I believe every man and every marriage has a chance of always shaping the future.
Very true.
You see, that's why the family has an impact on society. So you can say, yes, me, I never saw my grandparents, my dad, or my community. Hata kama wanaume wenzangu watanicheka. You know, you've seen those clips of like a group of men. You know, they are probably playing something or somewhere. And then one guy, the wife calls, and the guy ends with, I love you too. And the men burst out laughing. I'm like, dude, did you just say that? But you see, at the end of the day, you have to demonstrate. Because the world has shaped or our community will shape us in a certain way that you are not supposed to. But I believe as an individual, you can make a choice.
I love that. I love that. And because what the second question is about physical touch, and it's something I actually, it was going also to be my question to Hannah in this sense. What do you feel about physical touch, cuddling, hugging in public, you know, PDA? What do you feel? What's your feeling about
like
that?
Like he said earlier, I grew up in a very expressive environment.
Yes.
My dad was very expressive. So I never really, coming into marriage, it's funny because that's something I didn't. My dad would hug me when I was his little girl. You know, would hug me, kiss me as, you know. So when I came into marriage, that was something that wasn't foreign for me. But him, because of how he was raised or what he just didn't want. I remember there's a time as we were in a season of dating. We were in that, I don't know whether you can remember, we were at Komashio. We had gone to Nairobi to do something. And then I start, we enter the matatu.
Why do I feel like laughing already?
In the matatu. And I start holding his hands, and I just wanted to lean on his shoulder, and I could see how cringe he was. Like, we are not even on the streets, we're in a matatu, like, dude. So when we got home, I was like, babe, I mean...
Did you feel offended?
No, I didn't feel offended.
But you were like,
yes.
Why?
But I really thank God from the onset, we've always had this culture of, I will ask, you know.
What's, nice,
What's this? Where is it coming from? And so he's like, you know what, babe, me, I don't have to show it. Like, why? No one should know how I express.
It's enough for you. You know I love you. That's it. Why do you need to show the whole world? That was my perception there.
That was but over time, he has, he's not yet there yet, but he really tries, especially in public. Especially in public. But one thing I would just say to a couple that is, one person leans more into physical touch and the other one doesn't. Just give it time. Don't try to change him or her. Just allow that adaptability to come as you guys progress. Don't force things. He's gonna grow into it, or she, if it's the other side. And just allow them, give them that time to grow.
And you know, between the two of you, who's an introvert, who's the extrovert, who's the introvert?
Oh, I was the introvert.
You were the introvert versus the extrovert. Because I'm seeing a question from one of our viewers, and they're asking, you know, if you're in a relationship and communication in marriage is a bit, you know, challenging, how do you increase communication when your partner is an introvert, Percy? You're the extrovert, so you'll answer that.
I would say it's something that you have to openly do. What do I mean? One of the things that I've come to learn in marriage is even with the challenges that surround marriage, don't put up walls. You know, bring the walls down. And I believe your partner should be comfortable enough to tell you, hey, I don't like this. It's the same way. Sometimes, I mean, pengine nikajasho na kwamba eh kwani leo kumekuaje, you know, don't take offense, you know, and sorry. Yeah. There is the aspect of relationship mm-hmm. where I can say where your partner is your friend.
Yeah.
You know, mm-hmm. picture it, Sally, you and your best friend, mm-hmm. You know.
Yeah.
You can talk about anything. You see, mm-hmm. and without feeling mm-hmm. like mm-hmm. I need to explain myself yeah. to this other person mm-hmm. yeah. or I need mm-hmm. to ask for permission.
Right.
You see, mm-hmm. and when somebody is your friend, mm-hmm. You should feel the comfort and the security of, mm-hmm. you know what, mm-hmm. This is what. Mm-hmm. When you do this kind of things mm. or when you mm. Handle me like this, right. I feel loved.
Okay.
You know, mm-hmm. Like what my wife is saying, mm-hmm. Especially on the physical touch, mm-hmm. give it time,
okay.
but always introduce the topic. Kidogo tu.
Yeah.
You know, look for moments. Mm. There are those moments when mm-hmm. all of you are jolly and you're like, hey, but mm-hmm. there's something I want to tell you. Mm-hmm. I usually prefer this. Or if you get to notice they have done it,
yeah.
you compliment. Actually compliment.
Yes.
Say, by the way, I love that. mm-hmm. You know what you did? You have no idea.
Mm-hmm.
Let them understand.
Yeah.
That way you've communicated.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how do you get through to an introvert?
Mm-hmm.
One, mm-hmm. you have to understand the difference.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you may be out there, probably them, they're reserved.
Mm-hmm.
Also give them that understanding
okay.
and respect that understanding. At the same time, mm. also give them time,
mm.
you know, mm. adaptation,
yeah.
you know, adaptation yeah. is very key.
Mm.
Don't push,
yeah.
don't force,
mm-hmm.
you can't change anybody,
yeah.
you see.
Yeah.
Then number two, you can also look for the things that they flow with,
okay.
you know, mm-hmm. and you get to begin from that angle. Why?
Okay.
It's an easier way
mm.
as you try and get them out,
mm.
you know.
Okay.
And mm. For example, my wife, when mm. it comes to things like public, yeah. she was very reserved,
oh, yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
Look it. Okay.
Myself, I'm the one who yeah. my friend has this. Let's go.
Yeah.
You know, I almost pull across everything.
Yeah.
You know, I have more functions
yeah.
around me than her.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, when I saw you first, yeah. I actually thought
yeah, you're the extrovert.
Yeah.
The
maybe
extrovert.
To make a caveat.
Yeah.
I think it's because also. To talk to the couple where one is the extrovert
yeah.
and the other one is the, like in our case,
mm. yeah.
the extrovert also has to over time just provide that safe space. Because
yes,
for me,
safe space, yeah.
Babe, you reach a point where I really mm. felt, and I've told you this several
yeah.
times,
mm.
that mm. I felt he didn't push me. He wasn't forcing me mm. into, for
yeah.
example, the fact that we're in ministry and
yeah.
he would be on the pulpit every time.
Mm-hmm.
I was very uncomfortable.
Yeah.
I'm not that person.
Mm-hmm.
I was the
mm.
backbencher. I don't want to be told to do anything.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love Jesus. Let's just,
mm-hmm.
yes. But he provided a very safe space where he just kept encouraging me and allowing me to grow into
mm.
that position mm. where, oh,
mm.
it's Pastor Shad's wife,
mm.
you know, and she can now go and do this and this particular role. But
mm.
I think you have to provide that space, safe space for
yeah.
this person who is now an introvert
mm.
to now come up.
I love
and
that.
And you have had over time also,
mm.
couples have been saying, as you come into marriage, one is the extrovert, the other one is the introvert.
Mm.
But as you provide that safe space,
yeah.
over time now the roles, or rather the
change.
Personalities
yeah.
interchange.
Yeah.
Mm.
Or rather you find now this person who was an introvert now
mm.
has also
yeah.
come up.
Really?
And she can now talk, you know, or
okay.
now even talks more
yeah.
than the person who was, you know, perceived to be the extrovert.
I see compliments to you, by the way, guys, already saying you've done a good job to give your wife that space, the environment to just be herself.
Yeah.
There's that.
Mm.
And then there's also compliments are coming in fast and
mm.
furious. Thank you so much, guys. Great
mm.
discussion
mm.
there. I miss such life after my 18 years mm. of marriage crumbled due to third party. And we are so sorry.
Mm.
We are so sorry about that. And then, you know, as we get, because what I'm realizing is the comments
mm, yeah.
and questions are just
yeah.
exactly what we are going to discuss. So
yeah.
why
yeah.
not? And
mm.
Nice for yourself. Can
mm.
we classify provision as love language and the act of service?
Wow.
That's a good question.
Yeah, mm.
I wouldn't really classify it
mm.
Per se. And at the same time, I would.
Mm.
Let me explain.
Yeah.
When it comes to, let me say, the traditional
mm.
roles, in quotes,
mm-hmm.
of a man
yes.
is to provide.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I was also giving a comparison
mm.
of generations.
Yes.
Our parents, for them, they felt, you know what, mama watoto, weka kwa nyumba. See, I have the job.
Yes.
See, I'm able to provide. Sure. You just take care of the kids, you see. And for him, as long as he was able to do that, he felt it was an obligation. This is my duty as a man. Come to our current times, you know, things are different. Your wife can be the one who works first, you see. So what does she do? She becomes the
provider.
You see, does that mean that you as a man not able, for whatever reason, and in this case I'm not including laziness, for whatever reason you're not able to work, it doesn't make you less of a lover.
Absolutely.
You see, because you're not able to provide.
Yeah.
So there's a thin line. However, when it comes to provision, whether it's the man or the woman, I believe when you have those moments as a couple, you're talking, it's just always, you know, say the word, you know, thank you for taking care of this, you know, thank you. Sometimes she tells me, hey, thank you for taking care of the rent. Me, I'm like,
it's my obligation, it's my duty,
I'm the man, I mean, but sometimes I also sit and I tell her, you know what, you're doing a good job with the kids. You'd think, it's a woman's
natural
role to,
it's only natural for us to do that.
But you see, when you have these pockets, for her, I mean, for her, it means a lot that I'm able to recognize. It may not be the love language per se, but you recognizing that somebody is contributing towards the marriage and relationship goes a long way.
All right. I hear you. Now, of course, I believe that it hasn't just been a very smooth ride throughout, you know, conflicts here and there. How have you been able just to reconnect and maintain that love, you know, forgiveness, love, and all that? Have been able to reconnect even after a conflict or disagreement? Anna, go first.
I totally believe in just being very transparent, and I think I'm just gonna probably take this question in by giving a story. For example, I think it was our second year of marriage, and let me just say there was just an issue that we weren't like agreeing on. And I just felt like he didn't understand me, or rather where I was at that particular time. But this is the thing, he allowed the Holy Spirit to kind of, because he just kept at that particular season, there's something he wanted me to, or rather a position he wanted me to rise to, and I wasn't. And he just kept pushing. Like, I don't get why you don't want to do this thing. You're capable of doing this. But I just felt it wasn't the time. But then I think he just had time with God and just went in prayer and was like, okay, God, I'm really trying to make her come up to this particular position, but she's not. What do I do? And he allowed the Holy Spirit to minister to him. So all I remember is that one particular night he comes home and he's like, can we just talk? And I'm like, yes. And he tells me, you know what, babe, I'm sorry, first of all, that I've been pushing you to come to this particular point. And I'm going to allow you to just take your time. And I'm also going to allow God to minister to you. And so I think for me, number one, what I would say is just taking a pause and allowing God to speak into that situation. Don't try to to run it the way you think it should be run, or to, you know, just jump into conclusions. Allow the Holy Spirit and God to just come and minister into those situations where you're feeling, hey, this, I don't know how we can resolve this. And so for us, that particular moment was really key for me, because I realized, oh, this is a man who just won't, you know, tell, no, we have to do this and do this now. You have to,
it's
just
not
get
his
it.
Way,
you know, it's
highway.
Not his way all the time. And he just said, you know what, I'll just allow God to minister to you. And guess what? After that, it was so easy for me to just recognize that, oh, he actually wasn't, you know, being, you know, a bad spouse. You know, he just wanted me to come up and do this particular thing. And so I would just speak to couples and just say that sometimes just allow God to speak into those moments where you're feeling this is too much and you don't know how to resolve it. Allow God, allow the Holy Spirit to minister to you and show you the way and how to resolve it.
I love something that you've just said, Hannah, that, you know, during that period, he came out and said, I am sorry.
Yes.
So I want to come to Percy and, oh, is it even you? You actually apologize, and how do you do it? Is it gifting? Is it, do you say it? Because it's very difficult for most men to just say sorry, or even women. Or even it's a difficult thing to say. So you know, I picked that you actually came and said, I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's I thank God I've come a long way.
Yeah. Wow.
Like what you're saying,
yeah.
I was never the one who would apologize, you know. And I remember, I think the early, like actually the early days of our marriage, I would be like, you know what, I'm the dude, you are the woman. I'm the head, you know. And in any case, ufai kunikasirisha.
Yeah.
You're the one who's trying to make me angry.
Yeah.
I don't get angry generally, but you are trying. You are provoking me.
Yes.
But I said something because it's around conflicts. First of all, even put the pastor title down or whatever position. As a believer who is not even consistently walking with God, like you don't pray often, you don't read the Bible often, the Holy Spirit is there, you see. And as long as you are walking with God, even not so actively, God will always minister to you, you see. And now for as long as you're walking with Him, there's something that God will tell you more often than not concerning you, and also how you relate with your spouse, because you're always together. You know, there are words you will say that are not right, you know, in a moment of anger, in a moment, and I've realized when somebody is really tired, those are moments where the enemy is always like an attempt opportunity.
Strife.
You see, so when there's a conflict, always dissect it. You know, where is it coming from? You know, and also listen, try and listen. Sometimes when you're sober, the Bible says, first of all, a soft answer turns away wrath.
Yes.
You know, in the book of Proverbs. So with my walk with God, there are moments I felt, you know what, that was wrong.
Okay.
There's that aspect, you know what, me, I'm from Central. To Semangi, Apana, no, I'm a man. Why should I say sorry? Why should I say? But when you are having, reading the word, and like you're seeing that, you know, Ephesians chapter 6, you know, let your words edify. You're like, oh my God. I didn't.
Yeah.
I crushed her.
Yeah.
You know, when I spoke these sharp words, I actually demeaned her.
Yeah.
I watered down her confidence. What do I do? I go back and say, you know what?
Yeah.
I was wrong here.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
It was never easy, you know. And sometimes she's there are moments where I'm like, no, you haven't said sorry.
I like how you know, it's been a journey for you. You've worked it for you to get to this place of saying sorry. Really, you know, whatever conversation you're having here is even having an impact on a 19-year-old who is saying, morning, fam, mind you, I'm 19 and really enjoying the conversation. You people are living my dream. So we thank God for that. And I think someone is trying to sabotage me by the time. We are actually about to end the show. And maybe I'll just ask you to give us very briefly your closing remarks, advice, or, you know, comment to our viewers and listeners, because we're just about to be wrapping up the show. And I will go with you, then Percy will wrap it up.
All right.
Wow.
Very briefly.
I think I'll just go back to what I said earlier as we were starting the show. Marriage is a learning curve. Allow God to, I think if there's any best teacher I would recommend, it's the Holy Spirit. Allow the Holy Spirit to journey you through, even when it comes to the love languages, because you can still anyway do all you can in terms of making sure that you tick all the boxes, or I'm giving the gifts, spending time, or you know, doing this, all these acts of service, but then And it still doesn't, you know, doesn't give the results that you expected. But bottom line is, let the Holy Spirit lead you, you know, in your marriage. Yes, that's what I would say.
My bishop in one of the sessions once said that in every man mm-hmm. and in every individual,
yes,
there's a king and a fool.
Okay.
And you being able to mm-hmm. discern the difference is wisdom.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And you have to realize that even in my wife, mm. there's a way I can talk to her and mm. I see another side.
Okay. Mm.
And there's a way I can talk to her or I can even do something mm. and I see a pleasant mm. side.
Okay.
Now, love languages come to help us to mm. be able to bring out the mm. kingly or the queenly in the other person.
Okay.
And the key thing is to understand that it's a journey, mm-hmm. it's a process, mm-hmm. and God is there.
Okay.
The Bible says in John 14:16 that God is love.
God mm. is love.
And if God okay. is able to express love to us,
okay.
then we can also express love to people.
Fantastic.
It's only that the communication is what? Mm. Is different.
Okay.
Thank you.
Asante sana, sana, sana. I wish we had more time. Lately, these shows have just been the bomb. But thank you so much, guys, for the time. Thank you for making time to come.
Thank you.
And welcome. Thank you, my viewer and my listener, wherever you, are. Asante ni sana for your time being with us. And also thank you to each and every person who has been with us walking this journey and just donating whatever they get or they have and whatever God places in your heart to bless this particular ministry. We want to say thank you and keep doing it. Keep, you know, if you want to be part of this or if you want to donate, just send your donation to paybill number 316316 and the account will be your telephone number. Whatever God blesses you with will go a long way and impact many lives. God bless you and have a fantastic, fantastic Thursday. See you next week on another very interesting episode on Family Matters. God bless.